building trillion frame per second cameras that can see around corners. A 2D display now, where if you have prescription, you put that prescription on the tablet so that you don't have to wear glasses, you can see the tablet. The rest of the world is still blurred to you.
And welcome. I'm talking to Ramesh Raskar from MIT Media Lab. Ramesh, trillion frames a second to a low-cost eye device like Nethra. It's a huge world to traverse. Tell us more about it.
Sure. I think at MIT Media Lab, we really believe in being anti-disciplinary.
Yeah.
And we want to do research that's not defined by a given field.
Hmm.
So we're building trillion frame per second cameras that can see around corners and see deep inside.
How is that even possible? Tell me as a layman.
Sure. So to create cameras that can see around corners, that's what you're asking for.
Yeah.
We actually use scattered light.
Right.
So if you have to kind of see around you, I'll shine light on the floor, it goes behind you. Part of that light reflects back to the floor and back to the camera.
Yeah.
And by bouncing light from other visible surfaces,
right,
we can actually see what's around the corner. But to analyze that, we need a very high-speed camera.
Right.
And that's why we have this so-called trillion frame per second camera,
right,
that we have built. And so that's, you know, that's fundamental science for exploring propagation of light and how it interacts with matters and using it for medical purposes, for automotive, and so on. On the other hand, you know, there is a need for solutions like iNetra, where there are 300 million people in India who need prescription for their eyeglasses, but don't wear eyeglasses.
Mm.
And the numbers worldwide are similar, you know. Mm. So these are huge challenges. And when I was working with some other technology, I realized that actually I could transform that to solve the problem of getting eye tests.
Mm-hmm.
So although I have no background in optometry or ophthalmology, now I feel like I have a degree in ophthalmology because we have designed not only this instrument, iNetra, but series of instruments after that.
Okay, so light seems to be the common factor.
Yes.
And the speed at which it moves or doesn't move.
Yes, we love playing with light.
Right. So Ramesh, tell us a little bit about yourself. I mean, you know, how did you get into this whole world of light and research all related to light and then at MIT?
Yeah, so I grew up in Nasik, very close to Bombay. And growing up, I had this fascination that the world doesn't exist if I don't look at it.
Mm.
And so if I, when I look around, the world is getting painted.
Correct.
And if I don't look behind, it doesn't exist. And I really wish I had kind of eyes behind my head. And that's, by the way, exactly what virtual reality is.
Mm.
You know, when you put a virtual reality glasses, it's only creating images of what's in front of you.
Mm.
And as you look around, the images start getting painted again by again by computer in real time. It keeps up with your head movement.
Right.
And so I was kind of thinking in virtual reality even when I was, you know, 10, 11 years old. And my fascination with visual imagery has stayed with me.
Mm.
And so after I did my engineering in electric engineering, I did a lot of work in computer vision and computer graphics and machine learning. And then now I'm very excited about how we can combine the software and hardware, you know, image processing, computer vision, machine learning, with light, which is optics and sensors and displays.
Right. You also worked with Mitsubishi Electric and then you moved to Media Lab, which is a little more idealistic, I would imagine, from a pure corporate commercial background.
Yeah. So I worked at MOL, which is the research lab for Mitsubishi Electric in Boston.
Mm.
And, you know, I had 50 patents and converting many of my ideas into products. But then I realized there's a much bigger playing field. And so I moved to MIT and I'm working on various areas from medical imaging to 3D displays to ultra-fast cameras and computer vision.
Right. So tell us about coming back to, you know, iNetra. What's the, how do you, the whole framework for creating something that's as low cost and affordable as this for a market like this, but sitting out of Boston?
Definitely. So I did not set out to create a eye test device at all.
Mm.
This is the interesting part. Actually, I had created, I and my group had created another invention called Bocode, which is a very tiny barcode that can store a lot of information.
Mm.
And it turns out if you look through Bocode, if you have a good eyesight, you can see it very well.
Mm.
If you don't have a good eyesight, you can't see really well.
Mm.
And then when I was showing it around, we realized actually we can use the same exact solution, the barcode solution, to actually check people's eyes.
Mm.
And so this is kind of a combination of optics and hardware. And all we have, by the way, is just a mobile phone.
Right, okay.
And we snap the mobile phone at the back of the binocular.
Mm.
And then you look through this, you know, click on a few buttons.
Mm.
When you're done, you hit calculate, and it gives you prescription for your eyeglasses.
Right. So it's also measuring your, how bad
nearsightedness, farsightedness, astigmatism, and it can look at, it can give you a prescription that's more accurate than traditional devices.
Okay.
And the best part is because it's sufficiently portable and low cost, you know, a optometrist or optician can take this to schools and scan, you know, many children taken to railway station or mall or factory and scan hundreds of people in a few hours, as opposed to waiting for individuals to come to the shop. So we think, you know, there are 300 million people who need glasses in India. The only way we're going to solve that problem is through technology like this.
Right. So tell us about some of the other areas that you're working on.
Sure.
And also, if you can very briefly paint for us, what's the kind of innovation environment? I mean, how do you create an innovation environment which, one, is of course spans such a wide area, but also create something that's really ready for market or at some point ready for market?
Yeah. I mean, these are, you know, these are huge challenges. And I think one of the biggest challenges for one has to realize when it comes to entrepreneurship in, you know, tech-heavy areas like medical devices or impact in transportation or health or education, is that often the innovator cannot be the entrepreneur. And this is a very, very important realization, because, you know, we have the Bill Gates and Mark Zuckerbergs of the world who started with an idea and took it all the way and convinced others and formed teams and raised funding, started a company and are running a company. But that does not happen in many areas. And so through my work, what we're trying to do is create a pool of innovations and a pool of entrepreneurs and bring them together through so-called innovation camps. And so iNetra is an example where the company is doing really well and it has done, it's serving thousands of customers now. Nevertheless, it's not the most efficient way of getting a technology out, I would say. You know, we have 20 such ideas of other ways, other eye tests you can do that are unrelated to getting prescription of eyeglasses. And through our partnership with Alvi Prasad Eye Institute, we said, you know what, let's not do one thing at a time. Let's do 20 things in parallel. And so we're able to marry a lot of the inventions from MIT, a lot of the innovators who are interested in solving such problems. And now we have a relationship with Alvi Prasad with an innovation center there, and we're able to do 10 or 20 projects in parallel. And we hope many of them will actually
become real spin-offs. So you're saying one lesson is that work on multiple things at a time. Don't assume that, you know, don't sort of have a linear approach to innovation. And
exactly. Be open-minded and let your ideas be out there.
Ramesh, last question. So what are the one or two things that you're working on which will see light of day soon and you're really, really excited or passionate about?
So in my lab, of course, we are doing, you know, a lot of cool technology, augmented reality, virtual reality, machine learning, and so on. We have a 2D display now where if you have prescription, you put the prescription on the tablet so that you don't have to wear glasses, you can see the tablet. The rest of the world is still blurred to you, but the tablet itself is sharp. We are also working on, you know, series of medical devices to do with your hair, skin, saliva, heart, lungs, and so on, every part of your body, infectious diseases. So we have about 20 projects going on that are looking at various diagnostic devices. And then we are also looking at...
And these are devices which will obviously pair with apps and mobiles.
Yeah, it's connected devices that, you know, mostly use light to see the world, to see the health condition, but also it's predictive analytics. So we can actually start predicting your condition even before you start showing all the other symptoms, all the serious symptoms. And then separately, we are working on Kumbh Mela, which is a major effort, taking up a lot of my time now. And Nasik is where the next Kumbh Mela is, close to Bombay. And about 30 million people show up for about a month in Nasik. And it's a huge challenge. And previously, in previous Kumbh Melas, it was purely a government-run operation, where they take care of transportation, and medical facilities, and so on. But in reality, most people refuse to go to such Kumbh Melas because their facilities are not available. Food, transportation, housing, they're concerned about epidemics,
security,
and so on. Security, of course, civic issues. And so what we're doing is we are encouraging the local innovators and entrepreneurs nationwide to see if they can use this Kumbh Mela as an opportunity to actually start new businesses. And so through collaboration with MIT and Harvard, and some other institutes, we are brainstorming what are some problems worth solving and engaging local innovators. And then we ran an innovation camp in January of 2014. We have another big coming up in January of 2015, where we're going to take very important problems, whether how do you use cell phone tower data to do mapping of crowds, or how can you create cashless transactions, where even if you're not carrying a mobile phone, you can pay a local merchant. Or how can you create new maps that are customizable on a day-to-day, hour-to-hour basis that can be sold to pilgrims. And there's a very nice startup that's creating customizable maps on the fly. Another startup is looking at distribution of food and logistics behind that, and actually engaging local restaurants and local home food makers. Mm. And how can you standardize them? How can you regulate them so that they're part of the larger ecosystem of food distribution? So there are a whole bunch of startups that are looking into this. And our team at MIT is constantly brainstorming of how this individuals, through technology, through crowdsourcing, through gamification, through portable solutions, and not necessarily relying on infrastructure or government support or manpower, can solve these very important problems. Sounds so that's last week of January, and I encourage everybody to just go to mitindia.info, right. One word, mitindia.info, and sign up there.
And it sounds truly fascinating. All the best to you, Ramesh, and it was a pleasure meeting with you.
Thank you.
Thank you.